Welcome to Qt Widgets and More. This episode is not for you if you don't use Model View. It's neither for you if you never ever make any mistakes when you code. But for the rest of you, maybe you should watch this. So curious now, huh? Well, this episode is about a new class in Qt 5.11 that is called QAbstractItemModelTester. It was actually around Qt since the Qt 4 or maybe even Qt 3 days, but it was always only in the unit test of Qt itself. But now, my good friend and coworker Pepe had put it into public API of Qt. So what does it do? Well, it exercises your QAbstractItemModel subclasses in numerous ways, like asking how many rows do you have? And if you're a tree, can you give me data deep down in a tree, not just at the top? If you say that you add, by emitting the right signals, that you add new rows, did you actually add those new rows? And so on, and so on. You create an instance of it, and you attach it to your model, and it listens to your model and exercises your model. And that's the first part of this episode. But let's start looking at the code for this. So this code here, you could actually find that in one of the previous episodes. It's about this Depeche model. I love it still. And I put that model into a tree view. It looks like this whenever you run it. We have a tree view with my model attached to it. Actually, the tree view is there isn't much because it's just a simple table, but nevertheless. At this stage, I would like you to pause the video and think, what kind of errors have you ever made in your models? Okay, I'll give you an example of an error that you likely have made in your models. You have forgot to test for the row. If you forget to test for the row, what will happen in the data method? Well, the view will ask, so what is the text on item, this particular item? And you will say, the text is USA. Then it'll say, okay, cool. Can you tell me what is the color? It will ask for the foreground color. You'll say, USA, and I'll say, that's a really weird color. Okay, never mind. What is the size hint? And things will go really south from there. Depending on what view you have, you might not see anything, or you might just see the cell, which is the case in the table, for example, because there the size of the cell is dictated by the table headers themselves, saved by the bell. But it will also ask you, should this item be checkable? And when you answer USA to that question, it will say, okay, that must mean yes. So I modified the model slightly here. I added a hash mark define. Oh, did I forget to check the role? And as you can see for the grayed out code down here, what I do not do anymore is test the role. I simply unconditionally, in my data method here, I return for any of the roles, I return what I would have answered in my display role. Let's see what that looks like when I run the application. Looks like this. And you go like, that is weird if that had been your own code. Why am I only seeing the first column? I would expect it to see multiple columns. I'll give you a hint. Size hint? Maybe? I don't know. Well, you can debug that if you want. Or you could just do like this. You could go to your code and You can instantiate. No. Oh, come on. There we are. You can instantiate a class of QAbstractItemModelTester. Yes, I needed to read that up. And what it does take is a model and it takes a failure mode. And now when I run it, what I'll see is that it says fail variant can convert Q size. And that's exactly the size hint that was asked into the model. And the model said, okay, USA, or whatever it said. And then the model tester tried to convert that string into a Q size for the size hint role, but it couldn't. Let's try and look at this in the debugger. It is unfortunately slightly painful to get to exactly where was that error location. So that's why I'll like to take you by the hand and show you what it looks like when you run this in the debugger. So inside my debugger here now, F5, or inside my Qt creator, F5 to start the debugger, It starts up, it crashes because I specified that I want it to crash whenever I hit an error. And you can see down here, this, the calling frame, or the crashing frame is this queue message logger fatal that I have right here. And well, the last one that makes sense for us to look at is this frame here. It's in QAbstractModelTester private verify. And if we look at the statement string over here, variant can convert queue size. Okay, let's try and go one stack frame up. And you can see here, that's pointing to this line here, model tester verify variant can convert queue string. Wait, what? Didn't you say queue size? Yeah, sometimes your debugger can get slightly confused. It should, of course, have been pointing to likely this line down here, which you can verify if you simply step your way into this. But let's go further up to see what is happening. So all the way at the top, that is the code where I instantiate my QAbstractItemModelTester class. And here, the QAbstract, this class, it does two things. First of all, it will hook up to it will bang on your model right away when you instantiate it. But it will also, as we can see, when we go up the stack here, you can see that it's connecting a bunch of different signals. And then whenever you emit those, it will bang on it again. But this was just in the initial banging of your model. And if we go down again here, well, up depending on how you see it, down here, I can see that I'm calling this method and then I am crashing in my variant. Wouldn't it be nice if I could, like, wherever I have my model here that I call index 0, 0 and then dot data, wherever it is, I can't find it in my code. Wouldn't it be nice if I could just step back to that time of execution and go in rather than I got the data back and now it crashes? Wait a minute. Isn't there an episode on going back in time? There is. And this is one of the places where I really always bring up my RR and I can step back and go into where I called the data method and see exactly what was going on inside my model that made it return the wrong data. Of course, you could just have put a breakpoint on the can convert. Where are we? You're gonna put, this is the can convert, the variant comes from here. You could put a breakpoint on line 615 and then you could step in here. But trust me, the model view framework, it's not something that is very breakpoint friendly because you get called lots and lots and lots. So RR to the rescue. So if you instantiate the QAbstractItemModelTester class on all your models, or on your models whenever you're developing them, it will actually help you develop good and sane models. But it's actually useful to have them on all the time because something might change in your models that will actually make them misbehave. So can you just like globally turn this on? Yes, you can with the code that I'm going to show you. It's going to be a lot of hacking. It's going to be a lot of insights, knowledge of Qt. But with that warning out there, what do we want? Well, I want to be notified whenever a new subclass of QAbstractItemModel comes alive, and then I want to install the model tester on it. But how do I do that? Let me show you. Now, wouldn't it be nice if Q application, that would be a good one, had a signal being emitted whenever a new Q object came alive? Well, unfortunately, it doesn't. But let me show you. In the model testing class, which is a new class that I've created here, what I'll do is that I instantiate this model testing class. I test whether the environment variable QAM test model is set, and if not, I don't do anything. So in production code, I don't have the model tester bang at my model because that would be slightly too expensive. But in my debugging builds, wherever I do my own stuff, I always have this environment variable set, and then I will actually have this on all the time. Okay, so we go down here. And what I want to do now is that I want to be notified whenever a Q object, or whenever of course a Q abstract model is being instantiated, which is a subclass of Q objects. And what I do is that I instantiate this, a register event. So I get myself a new event. and then I do this code here. And if you're like, oh, I never seen that kind of code before. No, no. I think there's like three people in the world that ever written this. I'm one of them right now. Squish has written it. That's how Squish get to know things. And Gamma Ray has written it. That's how it can hook into your system and learn a lot of stuff. What it does is that it calls this method here, quam add object. It calls that whenever a new Q object is instantiated. And if you look at it's, I'm checking whether there's somebody already at this. And if there is, then I'm remembering them. So it could be that Squish or Gamma Ray was in already hooked up at this. Then I'm remembering them in this hook, and then I'm putting myself into the hook. And let's see what it does. So the hook is being called whenever a new Q object is being created. But I have the problem. At this stage, I'm constructing a QAbstractItemModel class, which we have down here. QAbstractItemModel is a subclass of QObject. But at this stage, I'm only in the stage of creating the QObject itself. So I can't even do a dynamic cast on the object. The only thing I can do is that I can send an event to the object, and that event will be delivered at the time when the object is fully constructed. So that's what I'm doing here. I am posting an event, not sending, I'm posting an event, which will go into the event loop and be picked out much later when the object is alive. Posting an event to the object, and the event is this new it's alive type that I just created below. And to hear that event, I will install an event filter, and really, really complex stuff here now. I'll install an event filter on the QApplication instance itself. And you can see I do that down here. QApp install event filter. So whenever my QApplication, or whenever an event comes to any object in my system, it goes through the event filter installed on QApplication, and that event filter is implemented down here. That's my implementation of it. And first of all, I test whether that event is it's a live type, and if it's not, it could be a mouse press event, or it could be a resize event, could be any kind of event onto this object. So if it's not that, I will just, not mine, I'll just continue on. Otherwise, what I'll do is I'll check whether somebody is in. As you can see here, I had a bit of problem with Gamma Ray. Whenever I attached Gamma Ray and had this enabled, Gamma Ray would crash because they didn't run the model tester, obviously, and there was some corner case that wasn't really a bug, but where Gamma Ray didn't answer the right thing according to the model tester. So if somebody else is in front of me, I would just say, okay, I will disable myself and return true, saying, yeah, I have been here, just to carry on. Okay. If we're down in this code, I know that the event type is this it's alive type. So now I take my object that the event came to, I cast that to a QAbstractItemModel. And if that goes well, it means that it was actually a QAbstractItemModel that came alive. One more test. I will test whether it has the property do not test model, if it has that property set. If it does, it means that the model itself said, yeah, do not run the model test on me because I can't be bothered fixing some corner cases. And in my own code base at home, I actually do have a few of those. And it also tests whether it's a calendar model or it's a queue completion model, because those, which comes from Qt, actually crashes in the model tester. Yeah. If it doesn't have this set, then I will continue down here. This line, you likely do not want that because it'll print out a lot of stuff, but it is just instantiating your QAbstractItemModelTester with this new model. It is saying that it should be in the warning. You could change whether it should be warning or fatal. If you say fatal, your application is going to crash right away, but you might actually want to see it continue on and then just have a breakpoint whenever it crashes in the warning. And I'm specifying the model as the parent to this, so that whenever the model dies, this connection will be torn down, or this instance will be torn down too. And the final piece is, how do the model actually, or how do a model say, I do not want to be tested? Well, it simply calls ignore. I simply call this a static method here, ignore model, using this abstract, using the model that I want to not test. And it set a property, namely the do not test property. That is the one that we have up here that says quam do not test. It sets this property to true, and that is what I'm testing up here. Model pointer property, if that is valid, meaning if that dynamic property actually existed. Wow, that was a lot to take in, huh? Do not go and clutter your code base with event filters if you've never seen those before. They are pure evil. I cannot warn you enough about event filters. They are sometimes the solution to a problem, but most often event filters can be really bad. And you might not have known about this hook either, huh? Well, let me give you an insight. Back in the early zeros, like 2002 or something like that, I was the main author of a tool that was in direct competition with Squish. And I actually asked for Qt to notify me somehow when new objects were created. And that's how this hook came around. Anyway, that's a bit of a side story. I am really hoping that you'll take this in and that you'll add it. Let me not lie to you. I have this running in my own code, and in 95% of the cases, when it complains, it's about something silly that I could be really bothered thinking about. And it's not really, really, really a bug. It's like, if you ask me for the fifth element, I already told you that I only have four elements. If I return you the wrong data, it's not really, you shouldn't be doing that. But it's not about the list view and the tree view and the table views above doing the wrong thing. It is about the proxy models that somebody else writes that ask you for things that they shouldn't be asking you about. And there, it's super useful to crash in a controlled way. And that is what this is all about. Thank you for watching yet another episode of Qt Widgets and More. I'm Jesper Pedersen. I'm from QAB. And we help people with this kind of thing. So reach out to us if you are ever in need of help with Qt.